So what I found was that within this great diversity of rich, poor, urban, rural, religious, spiritual, secular, there's actually a common worldview. And the premises are quite simple. In some ways, I think every child knows them, that the web of life is sacred and that we are part of that web. So we're actually living like we're separate. And it's because my sense is we actually believe somehow that we're separate. Of course, it's an illusion, but we're living that illusion, and so we are living in a way that lives out that story of separation.
Hi, welcome to Peak Moment. I'm Janaea Donaldson. I'm on Whidbey Island in Washington State, and I'm with Karen Litfin, who's a professor of political science at the University of Washington and the author of a pretty recent book called Ecovillages, Lessons for Sustainable Community. Karen, thanks for joining me.
Very happy to be here, Janaea.
You traveled around the world and visited something like 14 well-known ecovillages, right, on five continents. And I am just intrigued. Your book isn't so much about the you know, how do you live there, but what did you see? What did you learn that sort of caught your attention?
Right. Well, I am a big picture kind of person. My field is actually international law, international relations. And so I came to the point after teaching at the University of Washington for about 20 years when I realized that I was making my students really depressed and frustrated and angry and guilt-ridden because most of them are Americans. And I realized I needed to find something that actually could work for the long haul and to tease out the basic principles of what works. So I'm not really a nuts and bolts person. There's many people out there like Diana Leave Christian who has written a couple of great books on how to start a community and how to be in community. And that's something I'm just learning myself. But I wanted to understand what are the basic principles of sustainable living, because I feel that if we understand those basic principles of what really works, then we can apply them at every level, from the neighborhood to the city, to the state, nation state, and even international law, which is my field. So it's not like I'm abandoning my field by doing this. I just want to understand what really can work, because the treaties and the institutions at the global level are really inadequate and far too little and far too late.
Well, you know, you talk about in the book a little bit that we're sort of at a hinge point. I like that image between an old story, which the international law is going to be reflecting partly that old story, and I see this as your explanation for what the emerging story is.
That's great. Yes, exactly. I want to understand what is this new story that seems to be percolating up in different parts of the world. So one of the things I thought was, if I can do this global trip and I can visit ecovillages that are rural, urban, suburban, religious, secular, spiritual, you know, all different worldviews, all different socioeconomic classes, all different cultures, Africa, Asia, Australia, Europe, North America, and if I find some deep commonality there, then that suggests that something profound on a global level is happening. And my sense is it's not going to happen at the top from a top-down way. It's going to percolate up from the bottom in small ways. And we don't necessarily even need to go to ecovillages to see this. You see this in our cities and towns. You know, Seattle just unveiled a new bike sharing program, and you know, there's so much of this happening. But in the ecovillage, it's all very concentrated, and it's with people who have come together with this very clear, concentrated intention to live sustainably, and all that that means. That doesn't just mean having solar panels and carpools and or car sharing and growing your own food. It means so much more than that. It's how do we make a livelihood? How do we integrate our whole economy into ecosystems? How do we communicate with one another? That's the social dimension. How do we form our relationships in ways that are deeply sustainable. And then lastly, that would be consciousness. How do we become the kind of person? It's not last at all, it's actually first. How do we become the kind of person who can live in community, who can live in harmony with the planet? And so I call this E2C2. It's ecology, economics, community, and consciousness. So I think of those as basically the four windows through which you can look at sustainability. And the book is organized around those four chapters, mm-hmm. and looking at ecovillages through each of these windows. And of course, you look at economics, and people are trying to understand, how do I pursue right livelihood? Well, that's a deep question of personal consciousness too. So they're all intertwined.
Yeah, I can. It's a web. Right?
It's a web.
It's woven.
Yeah.
But you just mentioned that consciousness kind of. What I got was this kind of the foundation. It's because I'm sure that the people who self-select to be in an eco-village, which I vision as a sort of a pioneering effort, you know, in our cultures, or many of our cultures, it's not the norm. Tell me what you saw that people share, what may be in common in that consciousness. Yeah. Start there, and then we'll build all the way out.
Yeah, in the beginning of the book, I kind of lay out the basic worldview that I feel that I kind of teased out of my interviews with people. So I interviewed 10 people in each of the communities that I visited. And I should mention that two of those communities in West Africa and Sri Lanka were actually village networks. They're participatory development networks, COLAFIFA in West Africa, that works with 350 traditional rural villages, wow. and Sarvodaya in Sri Lanka that works with 15,000 villages. So these are not just...
It's not just a residential thing.
They're far-flung.
But a network that sees itself, that sees itself as an eco-village. What a model.
Well,
I've never heard of these.
What's interesting, it's very important in the developing world, because most people in the developing world live within one generation of their own family's traditional village. And so there has been this wave of urbanization because people haven't been able to find a way to live sustainably, economically, socially, ecologically on their land.
Sure.
And so in ecovillages, they start from the premise that we are part of the web of life. And if we are part of the web of life, then there must be a way of finding ourselves in that web. So I use the term evolutionary intelligence.
I love it. So, go ahead. What is evolutionary intelligence?
I was trying to find a term that is kind of an umbrella term for what I found in all these ecovillages, because some of them are quite secular. Like they're highly averse to the term spirituality. They're not, you know, in Svanholm, for instance, many people told me, Svanholm is in Denmark, they told me, I am just allergic to spirituality. Don't talk to me about that. Mm-hmm. So I don't want to use terms that alienate ecovillages. I'm trying to find a term that is really encompassing of quite a range of communities. And so evolutionary intelligence, I think, does that. It's the idea that we actually come from the earth, we are part of the earth, and that somehow we can tap into the intelligence that brought us here. And so that's a way of understanding the current juncture as, yes, a crisis of humanity, a crisis of sustainability, ecologically, socially. It's also a crisis of human meaning, like, who are we in this? And placing ourselves in that crisis with some faith that we can actually access something that will get us out of this into a new way of being. So for some people, that means something like permaculture, very hands-on, based on ecological principles, fairly scientific. For some people, it means praying and meditating. Mm. For some people, it means actually developing intersubjective fields in which we come into deeper and deeper communication to get to our core essence. For some people, it means communicating with plants. So you see, the evolutionary intelligence is very wide. And I think that's the challenge for each of us, is how do we find our individual contribution to this evolutionary intelligence. And ecovillages are full of people who are trying to do this together. So they're very concentrated experiments in, I would say, collective evolutionary intelligence.
And did you find that in any one eco-village, for example, you're finding people with those various ways in? The way I sense it is, if we're in the web of life and the evolutionary intelligence permeates everything, that's my thought, then there's all kinds of ways into that center, as you listed, which is exciting.
Yes.
Which says you can find yours.
Yes.
Now, in an eco-village, would you tend to find people with those many variety of things, or do they tend to sort of attract folks on a sort of similar wavelength?
That is a really good question. In fact, in some ways they need to attract people with on a similar wavelength. So eco-villages, by and large, are intentional communities. That means that people share an intention. Mm-hmm. And what I found is that the communities that had the most difficulty are the ones that where the intention was actually unclear in people's minds. They actually weren't sure that they shared a common purpose. And in conflicts, it came out. Mm-hmm. For instance, if you are if you see yourself as being primarily an educational center, that is a rather different purpose than seeing yourself as a place to really raise children,
mm-hmm.
you know?
Okay.
Or if you see yourself, like many eco-villages have different intentions, if you're here primarily to work at the level of consciousness, but most other people are primarily concerned about their ecological footprint, you know, they may not mesh all that well.
Okay.
So these are the kind of conflicts that come out that that eco-villages actually, because by and large they have pretty good communication skills, particularly the ones that I visited, because I was looking for what works.
Yeah, yeah.
They are able to find their way through these conflicts and find some common purpose. And when they don't, they have to sometimes revisit what their original mission was.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So this is this sharing of intention is very important at this point in our evolution, particularly in the affluent countries. We're living what I call hyper-individualism. And in that way of life, you actually don't need to come together with people around shared intention very much. But what that means is that because there's not a focus on finding clarity of intention, most people are unintentionally living out the intentions of the existing system.
Okay, I'm just taking that way. That most people are in mainstream, all of us are living, most of us are living what the mainstream culture story and values and worldview, which is a consumer culture, and you know, we're eating it, using it up quickly. So thinking about your intentions and how you live, it strikes me that that's a notion that's valuable for people, whether or not they're in an intentional eco-village.
Yes.
Or other experiments.
It's valuable if you want to live a full human life, because the default position is the dominant culture, wherever you are, not just in our culture. That's going to be the default position.
Sure.
And so you need to become very clear, what is your intention? And that's actually a fairly individualized activity.
Mm.
So I think of modernity, the era that we're coming out of, as having given us, in some ways, the gift of individualism, that we have, for instance, I can be a professor because somebody else is growing my food, and because I have doctors that I can rely on, for instance, for my diabetes, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So we have a very specialized culture in which we can become clear about who we are as individuals, and now the evolutionary need of the times is to give back that individuality to the whole.
Mm.
So I am a professor. I had to compete to get tenure and get a job and all of that. And I'm trying to look at how can I give the gifts that I have back to the whole. And we each have that.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So then I find that my students are thinking more and more in these veins. And in eco-villages, these are people, by and large, who get that. And they understand that one way to give back to the whole is to be with other people who feel similarly and do that collectively. So eco-villages also, besides being intentional communities, generally are educational centers. They're not little islands of people who want to live their happy green life, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
And some of them are doing that, but they're really interested in being part of the larger whole. So for instance, a lot of people really glorify off-grid, and off-grid is just fine, But there's a kind of thinking that goes with that sometimes that's, you know, separative, actually, that we can somehow be autonomous and be sustainable. But we are a global species now. Yes, as long as you are involved in the internet in any way, you are tied into the global system. Yeah. As long as you are sipping even a bit of fossil fuels, you're tied into the global system. And there's an aversion to it because we say, oh my gosh, it's unraveling the planetary life support systems. So we can face that aversion, but we need to leverage the resources from that existing system into a new world. So Ecovillages are doing that, and I find it fascinating.
So I have a question, since you've got to visit so many. What's in the I can imagine many people would look at wanting to be an eco-village, that many aspects of that could look really inviting. You know, other people to help raise your children, and other people shared minds, or shared meals, or lots of possibilities. Other people that share that worldview, which is going to be in our most of the world, you know, a few here, and a pocket here, and so on. But I also expect it's got to be very challenging in certain aspects. So can you talk to us maybe sort of what's in the shadow, or what's the challenge that you've found in Ecovillages? I realize they're each unique, but...
Yeah. So one of the questions that I asked everybody, I interviewed 10 people in 14 different communities, and I asked people, what is the most challenging aspect of life for you? Hmm. And I would say about 90% of them said other people.
I'm not surprised.
And so, you know, the individualized life that I just referred to, that sense of an enclave, something that's separate from the craziness of the rest of the world, that's very attractive to all of us, because we know other people are crazy. And actually, we secretly know we're crazy too, you know? And so, Ecovillages are a cauldron of human craziness, particularly because you get strong characters in Ecovillages. You mentioned that Ecovillages are pioneers. Well, they are. And you think about a pioneering species ecologically, they tend to be really tough, you know, really drought resistant, and they tend to be a little weedy, you know.
So. And in this case, probably some of those already know themselves well. Hyper-individual already to have made it enough in the old worldview, the mainstream worldview, to want to push towards those edges.
Exactly.
Right?
And so they want to express themselves, and many of them are very creative, and the Ecovillage is the perfect venue for them to express their creativity verbally, socially, artistically, technologically, you name it. So you get these hotbeds of creativity with highly individualized people. Parenthetically, I want to say that that's in the industrialized world more so, because here we're talking about what I call postmodern ecovillages.
Okay.
Postmodern ecovillages are full of people who are highly individualized, and they're ready to make the next step of bringing that individuality back to the whole. At least ideally, they're ready for that.
Sure.
Some of them actually aren't ready for that. And they find out. But in the traditional villages of West Africa that I visited, and Sri Lanka, in those places, you're actually working with pre-modern traditional villages trying to integrate eco-village principles. So they already have quite a sense of deep social connection in their villages. These are not intentional communities. They're not trying to necessarily go against the grain of modernity. Well, in a sense they are, but they're doing it from a different vantage point of having yet, for the most part, gotten highly educated and gotten highly specialized. They still know how to grow food. They still know how to build homes themselves. So they're trying to kind of enable themselves to stay in their homeland, basically, and not be going into the cities and going in this hyper-modern direction. So that's a very interesting thing.
Yes.
And they are also integrating postmodern technologies. Like, one of the main things that villages would like to have, I saw this a lot in Sri Lanka, was they would like to have internet access.
Yeah. Yeah.
So, you know, can you have a traditional rural village in a developing country with internet access? Yes. And in fact, we need that, because it's better if those people don't go into the cities.
Sure, yeah.
So I want to come back to this question of the most challenging aspect of eco-villages. Mm-hmm. So there is this shadow of not actually sharing an intention and finding it out after the fact. So there's that piece.
Okay.
And there's a piece about, you know, the very expressive, highly individualized people. But I also ask people, what's the most rewarding aspect of living in an eco-village? And again, about 90% of people said people, my human relationships.
Interesting. So it's the both?
Yeah, it's the most challenging and most rewarding. And we think that we don't want to be challenged, but actually people love a challenge. Give people a really good, meaty challenge with other worthy opponents, you might say, not necessarily opponent, but, you know, comrades and opponents, and people will tend to rise to it because it's juicy. So you have that happening in eco-villages. So, yeah, most challenging and most rewarding, and I think most of us find that in our everyday lives.
I was going to say, it strikes me as the human experience, regardless of maybe of all the times, you know, in history and in any culture, because other people, other relationships are what brush off our sharp edges.
Yeah.
They make us see the stuff in ourselves we don't want to see. Mm-hmm. Thank you very much. I'd rather keep it hidden to myself and them.
Yeah.
And yet that's also the gift, I think. I'm going to go back to the evolutionary intelligence. It feels to me that evolutionary intelligence of life blossoming on this planet as it and transforming isn't going to stop evolving. And we as a species aren't going to stop at this point. That our next invitation here is how can we take that individualism and become a different level of being at the level of a species that knows how to be more than one, you know,
yes.
Two, three, four, become some other level of, you know, awareness or a sensitivity that we haven't yet achieved because we need each other for that.
Right, and that is so much about communication, developing really good communication practices. And not necessarily only between people. That's our focus, because that tends to be where we get tripped up. But communication with the rest of nature, of the planet, the non-human nature, you know, because we are in a relationship with our planet, and it's not going so well right now. So we need to be able to listen to what is being said and respond appropriately. One of the stories that I tell is my story at Damanhur, of where they practice communicating with plants. And I was very skeptical. Actually, I believe it's possible to communicate with plants. I was pretty sure that I wasn't the kind of person who could do that myself.
Mm-hmm.
And I found out that I could. I'm quite certain that I communicated with a plant, and I tell the story in the book. Even somebody with a PhD from UCLA can communicate with a plant. And that is of use to know. Because many of us think, oh, we're too disconnected. We can't have that access.
Yes.
So the communication, and the nice thing about this kind of communication is it's direct. It doesn't have a big ecological footprint. So most of our little gadgets, you know, and all our jet travel,
us,
Lord knows I've burned more than my fair share of jet fuel in the name of sustainability. But all of this is highly technologically mediated communication.
Yes, yes.
So I'm really interested in this form of communication that is direct between people and with non-human nature as well.
And you get me to thinking, and we have about 3 minutes left here, thinking about Derek Jensen's reminder about a language older than words, of maybe the eco-villages are one of the cauldrons where we can tap into communicating not just with the plants, but what does the ecology around me want, or tuning into what the evolutionary intelligence suggests for things that are low tech.
And it really does boil down to intention, I feel, to be so clear and so core about what your intention actually is that you can feel that operating on a moment-to-moment basis in your own body. We can access this in our own bodies. And this is one of the things I try to help my students do. It's not some mystery, really. It's only mysterious because we don't have facility, we don't have practice with it. But it's right there. And we know it when we're with one another, when we're out of harmony. And we know it on the planet as well. So it's just, actually, for me, it's a lot of it's putting aside the sense of urgency and hurry to fix the problem, to actually be present to what is the problem and who am I in relation to that problem. And it requires sort of actually stepping back and feeling gravity root you, feeling your breath, you know, very simple practices. And that evolutionary intelligence, I feel, is actually running through all of us, and it's bubbling up all over the place right now because it is so needed. And Ecovillages in particular are nice little havens for this.
Thank you. Thank you for that. I'm pleased to get a reflection on sort of that deeper layer that's happening. I'll give you one more minute. These practices you're suggesting can be fit in everywhere, not just at Ecovillages. You want to say a word about that?
Yeah,
just a word,
actually, sure. My next research project is something that grows out of the work I've been doing for 20 years in the classroom. So as a professor of international relations, I am used to making my students really angry, depressed, frustrated, guilt-ridden, all of that. And I began working with this fact. And so I began teaching something I call person-planet politics. And it's the idea is we never study anything on a global scale that we don't bring home. So everything comes home. We study climate change, it comes home. And I bring students into meditative and reflective exercises in the classroom together, and we actually share about it, so it's not just these kind of solipsistic, individualized experiences. For instance, we study climate change, and I lead them through an exercise that I call Who Am I in a Changing Climate, where you actually bring together the cognitive information that you know with the somatic experience of how that lands in your body, and then bring that out into intentionality in your life. This is something we can all do no matter where we are. And if we do it with others who share something in our intentional field, it becomes even stronger. So that's where I think community is very important in this. These are not problems to be addressed solito. We need to do it together.
Thank you. Thank you. What a gem. You're watching Peak Moment. I'm Janaea Donaldson. My guest is Karen Litfin, giving us seeds of thought for everywhere and everyone. Join us next time.